Junior. Same thing.
So quickly call me, and then we also went on Mr. Pollard, who's going to play for me. But quickly call me. I am born and raised on the South Side of Chicago. Like everywhere on the South Side, 101st, South, 16th, 3rd, and Stony Island. Seeing Michael Jackson perform, like on TV, made me like, you know what, there's nothing else that I want to do. I didn't really grow up with a context for musical theater. You guys are lucky, even those of you who aren't necessarily into Broadway and all that, you guys are lucky that you had the exposure. And my grandparents, they would take us to like theater and stuff because they had like season tickets and stuff. But other than that, I really didn't know what music was worth, and it wasn't really an aspiration of mine. So it's kind of a divine intervention. And you know, blessing having the help of great teachers that allowed me to be in the position that I'm in. But my first passion, first and foremost, is you know, my singing, songwriting, soul music, folk music, R&B, pop, all that kind of stuff. I write for other artists. And this is just something I just kind of like luckily stumbled into. I went to Berklee College of Music in Boston first. Berklee is mad expensive, because I'm sure it's twice as expensive now. And so every time my parents could afford it, even the scholarships I got weren't enough, so I had to leave Berklee. I then went to Northeastern Illinois briefly on a classical music scholarship, because I had that in my background, thanks to my mother and thanks to Mrs. Kovacs teaching. And then my plan was like, you know what, it takes too long to be a famous opera singer, or it takes too long to like start making real money as an opera singer. Like, I don't want to do that anyway. So how about I go to California and try to pursue my singing, songwriting, try to pursue like acting or whatever. And so I went to California, applied to a bunch of schools, and just chose whoever was going to give me the most money. And that happened to be the American Music and Dramatic Academy. And then they have a New York campus and an LA campus. I went to the LA program for 2 years, finished there, did a few regional theater gigs. And then one day I auditioned for Lion King, got an equity card, that's the union, and you know, changed my life. Y'all. So during the course, how long did you have to tell me? Who in here has a desire to do musicals? Who in here has a desire to be a recording artist? You can be the same people. The best thing about, again, you guys are really lucky because I'm not sure how long Shike Arts has been around, but I know an arts high school wasn't really 6 years, what you saying, school?
Eight.
Okay, yeah, so arts high schools weren't really an option for me coming up. And if they were, then again, it just wasn't a part of my awareness. So no matter what your discipline is, whether you're focused on being on Broadway one day, whether you want to get a record deal one day, whether you want to work behind the scenes and be an A&R or a stagehand or a producer or something, it's great that you guys are in this place now because you're able to be exposed to a lot of stuff. What's good, man?
Hi.
What's happening? It's all good? Such a generous person. So long story short, it's just great that you guys are in this environment where you can hear a lot of different kinds of music, you're exposed to a lot of different kinds of art, and you can do this in school. I didn't even finish high school one time when I was supposed to, because I had to take like chemistry and stoichiometry and physics and advanced algebra trig. I know y'all looking at me, huh? Where they do that at? But what I'm saying is a blessing that you guys are here, and I hope that in your time here you take as much opportunity as you can to learn, not just from your teachers, but to learn from each other. Because what makes me, I think, a well-rounded artist isn't just the stuff that I grew up wanting to do, it was the fact that I had other peers peers and stuff to look up to, and different, you know, so the artists, the singers can be inspired by the visual artists, and visual artists can be inspired by the dancers. So I'm gonna shut up and I'm gonna do two songs. I think I'll give y'all the option. Would you like to hear Lion King or Hamilton? So, who's seen the show?
Probably. Lion King?
You seen it? I'm sure most of you guys have heard the songs on the show if you haven't had a chance to see it. I was fortunate enough to be a part of the first two workshops in Hamilton before they went to Broadway. Who can tell me what a workshop is? What's your name?
Hannah.
Hannah, what's up?
Hannah.
What's a workshop?
It's like the before process of like testing it out to see if people will like it and people can come. I think people can come see it, and it's kind of like a tester to see, and sometimes they take people to Broadway. Like I know they just did a workshop for Trevor out.
No doubt. So she's exactly right. A workshop is, it's a long process to get something on the movie screen or on the Broadway stage, and for musicals and plays, you have a workshop period where the writers, they've already created the music and may still be writing, but they need help once seeing it, especially for like Lin-Manuel Miranda, right? Because his plan was to be in it, but it's hard to kind of watch it while you're still working on it, and that's when you do the workshop process where you can hire other actors and singers to pretty much perform the music for people. So when I did the workshop in Hamilton, they were still looking for producers, and they had like all these big time actors and, you know, money people to get funding for the show. And this is Wait For It, which is a song by Aaron Burr from the show.
Life doesn't discriminate between the sinners and the saints, and taste and the
days that it takes. We rise and we fall. If there's a reason I'm still alive and so many have died, then how many knew?
But the challenge, especially for you guys who want to do musicals, is that when you're listening to a song like, what's the child's name? Alphabet, right? Like Defying Gravity. The temptation is to sing the song just like you hear it in a recording. And then you'll beat yourself up because you can't sing it like the recording. But when Hamilton is a great example. Right now they get up, you know, like Leslie Odom Jr. was the original Aaron Burr, right? And then eventually, like for the Chicago production, they brought Wayne Brady in. They didn't bring Wayne Brady so he could sound like Leslie Odom Jr. You know what I mean? They brought Wayne Brady so that he could sound like, bring his Wayne Brady-ness, if you will, to the role. And so again, that's what I want to encourage you guys to do, is to, you know, when you're studying your music, or your scenes, your lines, whatever, you need to know what's on that page. Because when a director wants to work with you, a music director wants to work with you, they want to know that you know what they wrote. However, don't be afraid to bring your own unique energy and artistry to the stuff that you're singing and the stuff that you're performing. Because again, that's the reason why they want to hire you and hire you and hire you, because you're a unique individual. If they just want to see the same person sing Alphabet, you know, they just hire Idina Menzel, you know, for 20 years, and that'll just be boring. Any questions? I mean, you know, music related, group situation, group music situation, and what you're forced to sing and to play with other people. Because the beautiful thing about jazz is that it lends itself to improvisation, but at the same time, when you're singing with a group, everybody can't be doing their own thing, or it's just out like a hot treasure mess, right? That's a great point. Do you guys have any questions about, you know, arts?
What do you think the hardest thing about being on the traveling tour is?
Well, it's definitely not being able to be home as much as you'd like to. Lion King, like, it's one of those shows that just never stops because people always want to see it, so we're on the road, you know, pretty much the whole year. The only reason I'm here now is because I took a week's worth of vacation, and I just, instead of going to Bahamas or, you know, Paris, all these dope places that people go on vacation, you know, I just want to come and, you know, see my family because it's not often that I get to see them, so that's tough. Being in different climates is definitely challenging because if you don't have allergies, some people develop them because just, you know, a month ago I was in Salt Lake City, Utah, which is incredibly dry and has high elevation. So, you know, you have people who have lots of different breathing issues, so you have to learn how to adapt to singing and performing in general in different climates. Not just with your vocal muscle, but, you know, the rest of your body as well. Your body won't always respond on a sunny day the way it does on a cold day, you know, in the middle of Chicago. So that's a challenge. But other than that, I mean, it's cool too, because I just said I was in Salt Lake City, Utah, and I wouldn't have never gone to Salt Lake just on my own. So it provides you the opportunity to see a lot of unique places that you wouldn't normally see. Recording my aspiring recording artist, can y'all raise your hands again? What should be?
Lauren.
What kind of recording do you need? Or if there's an artist who makes music that you enjoy, that you would make. Jasmine Sullivan. I'm gonna switch it up because I was gonna go 7 minutes, but I'm gonna switch it up real quick. For you guys who wanna be recording artists, how are you gonna go about doing that? There are many ways to get into that. a CD out and get recorded music out, especially in the internet age. But if any of you guys want to volunteer with some hands and tell me how you plan on one day getting here.
I feel like social media.
Social media.
So I mean.
No, that's real. So by social media, you mean YouTube, Instagram?
Yeah, YouTube, posting videos on Twitter.
Okay, for sure. Now, these videos, like, how do you go about, so you mean just like singing acapella?
Singing acapella, singing to a piano, a video you
sing. Yeah, for sure. That'll definitely give you exposure. Y'all know Chance the Rapper, right?
Yeah.
So the big thing with Chance is that for the most part, not completely, but for the most part, he's maintained his independence as an artist, which means that he records the music with him and his team, and they're not dependent on a distribution deal in order to keep the music out there. One of the benefits that you have with not just social media, but with iTunes and Spotify and these different outlets, is that you can record something literally on your phone right now and put it out there for sale, right? The challenge in that is that because anybody can do it now, it makes it tougher for your stuff to break through. That shouldn't discourage you, because it's always been tough to be a recording, a professional musician, a professional artist. So with that being known, how tough it is to break through, that shouldn't discourage you. But again, going back to that word I use, uniqueness, that should make you want to tap into what makes your art, what makes your voice, what makes it so special. I mean, I have lots of people I look up to, and I listen to them, like, to try to steal some of their vocal tricks or try to steal some of their acting techniques, but I don't want to be them, right? Because they already exist. Stevie Wonder already exists. Michael Jackson already happened. Donny Hathaway, these guys already happened. You know what I mean? So, again, going back to that word, uniqueness, as you're going through school and as you're going through the rest of your artistic lives, I want you guys to be able to, because it's going to be hard. You're going to look at certain people, like the people you're sitting next to now, you know, y'all might graduate at the same time, but one of them might have like a hit single by 20, and you'd be like 27, like nobody knows who you are. Don't be discouraged by what the crowd is doing. Focus on your own uniqueness, because when you hone that and when you perfect the artist that you are, then before you know it, people will want to come and see you.
Any other questions?
What's your name?
Laura.
What's up?
So first question, what did you major in college?
What did I major in?
Yeah.
I'm in a unique situation because I just jumped around all over the place. Because I was interested in so many different kinds of music and kinds of artistic expression. When I was at Berkeley, I auditioned with my voice. So the scholarships they gave me were for voice, but I wasn't a vocal major. I was a production and engineering major with a songwriting minor. The reason I chose those is because I felt comfortable enough with my vocals at the time where it's like I didn't necessarily want to spend, you know, 30 hours a week on my voice, even though you can do that on your own, and you can still go to different schools and take private lessons, even if you're not a voice major, right? For me, I wanted to start to learn like how to work soundboards and how to work, you know, DAW systems so that I can make my own music. And then, like I said, I went to Northeastern Illinois on a classical voice scholarship. Classical voice is fun, but it's not like where my passion is. And then that's when I jumped over to AMDA and stumbled into, you know, I was a musical theater student too, so I was taking dance and on camera acting and all that. So I'm unique. It was kind of all over the place.
Yes, so how much does like referring to recordings play into your process of learning material?
It's heavy at first, especially when you're learning something that nobody has ever worked on before, because at the time when Lin-Manuel Miranda and the team asked me to help them develop Hamilton, nobody had heard it before. Well, that's not true. Maybe 10 people in the world had heard it, like Lin and his closest advisors and friends, right? So all I had to rely on were the recordings that he recorded in order to learn, to kind of get a sense of how he wanted the music to go and how he wanted the feel of the show to go. I think that just comes also to with whatever permission you have from who gives you the music. For example, for you guys who want to be recording artists, one of the great ways to segue into an actual record deal is by finding a way to get backup single work. And then sometimes producers will ask you to demo recordings. So in other words, if they're writing a song for Rihanna, right, and they don't want to give, they don't want to sing on it. Let's say I'm a producer and I can't sing. I'm going to find you so you can sing on it and you can do what I'm expecting Rihanna to do. So in that instance, the producer gives you strict order in terms of this is how it has to sound. I know you have a fabulous voice on your own, but this song isn't for you. I'm paying you so you can sing it like Rihanna would sing. Right? So in those situations, it's very key to do what is instructed. In a live performance situation, it could be a little different because then people are paying to see you and then you have more artistic license to do your own thing. What's up?
Performing. I noticed when you were performing, yeah, you wasn't just singing, you was really into those lyrics. I guess what I'm trying to ask,
yeah,
like sometimes you can be put on the spot, you know? And how do you take about doing that?
No.
Okay, if you say so. Well, when I'm put on the spot, I really don't see. I don't see people. Yeah. I don't even see the person who asks me. I just go out there and do it. Right. You know? How do you?
Wow. I mean, you're much more brave than I was. I'm not just saying that. Like, there was a long time, like especially when people hear that you can sing or that you think you can sing, they're like, "Oh, say something!" Right? And it's like the most embarrassing thing, especially if you're not trying to pay attention to yourself. So sometimes I'm just joking around, like, oh no, I can't really sing. Like even now, like I'll go to like send some mail or whatever, like I just have to do my taxes, right? And then I was at FedEx and the dude saw I was sending mail to like Nevada and like all these different places, Canada, all these places I have to pay taxes to. He's like, "What do you do?" I was like, "Oh, you know, I'm an artist, whatever." And, you know, he kept pressing. I was like, "Okay, I'm in Lion King." He's like, "Oh, you're in Lion King, say something!" Singers especially know how hard it is to practice singing because that means somebody's always listening to you. If I'm practicing dance, right? So let's say I come here and y'all know me and I'm like, okay, you know, I'm learning to be a dancer. I'm gonna practice my turn. You know, if I did a turn and I fail, y'all would laugh, right? But no, you wouldn't. It's cool. But people are like, okay, that's cool. He's learning how to dance. When you're learning how to dance, you're gonna fall. When you sing, which by the way is not necessarily a horrible thing, especially at you guys' ages when your voices are changing, when your artistic moods are changing, right? Cracking when you sing, assuming that you're singing health, you know, with good health, with good vocal health, and good technique, cracking doesn't necessarily mean that you're horrible. It's just your voice is way of letting you know that you're trying to access something that you currently don't have to access. The high note, so as a Simba, the high note is a B flat, right? Sometimes they'll give you a lower key to sing in, so it's an A. I'm not warmed up at all, but I'm just gonna show you. The sun will rise! That was a legit try. The sun will rise! Two things. One reason I can't hit it right now is because I'm just not warmed up to sing that song. That's in this night, right? The other thing is that my voice, because in the show, this is another thing, even though I cover all these roles, right now the guy who I'm replacing in the show, because they fired this dude, and that's why I'm in the show now. Oh, that's right. The point is that during the day, I'm singing other stuff. I'm not singing Lion King stuff during the day. During the day, I'm trying to record my own music. I'm singing all this other stuff that has nothing to do with Lion King. And the vocal technique I use for my own stuff is completely different from the technique I use in Lion King. So I say all that to say is that my voice is not always warmed up at 12 noon or whatever time it is, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, to sing that note. The challenge, though, as vocalists, is that because in order to get the note, you gotta, you know, learn, I don't wanna say learn how to crack, but some cracking will happen. So I guess what I'm saying is that when it comes to practicing, whether somebody's putting you on a spot, or whether you're at home by yourself and you're singing in your room, try not to be ashamed. Right, because it's a natural part of it. If you lift weights, the way that the muscle gets bigger is literally by the muscle tearing itself. You understand? The muscle can't get bigger if you don't tear it. I'm not saying go out and destroy your voice, but you have to literally have some kind of adversity in order to get to the next level you want to get at. And your voice is not going to get to another level. It's not going to get these different notes and these different colors if you're just keep staying in a safe place and not challenging it. So one, bravo for you for just being brave for singing it and not paying attention to people. Help listening to the lyrics and focusing on the intention of the song helps those nerves. But again, also as a sidebar, when you practice your voices, especially, don't be ashamed. Even if you think it's horrible, I didn't like my voice for the longest time. And it took me to even maybe last year to be like, you know what? This is cool. I can kind of sing a little bit. Alright, y'all, respect.
So people do like come up to you and just like, okay, you said you sing, but you're not people or this is this. Same thing. Or your mom told you to sing, same thing, right? Okay, so it's like two issues.
Sure.
Okay, so the first one is like, as soon as somebody tells me to sing, even if I've been singing all day, I lose every song in my memory.
I know.
Like I just can't think of a song to sing.
Yeah.
And then, like, you have to hear the second part, like the speech, like, if a producer walked up to you and said, sing something, you wouldn't say something, you lose your record deal? Yeah. Like, what? If you heard I learned how to flip, and we in the mall, you gonna tell me to flip? Like,
you're absolutely right. That two important things there. One, what I learned to do, especially like when I was in high school, kind of press, you know, your ladies or whatnot. I would have like two go-to songs that, like, no matter what, if somebody put me on a spot, like, I'll be like, okay, I can sing this. You know what I mean? The other thing, too, is what you touched on is very important. As artists, just because you all are children right now, that doesn't mean that your art should be respected. And your artistry is time and place appropriate. Your teacher's asking you to do something, you need to do it. Again, as long as they're not asking you to hurt yourself, to compromise your values, whatever, you do what your teacher's asking you. If Timberland walks up to you on the street, Pharrell will come up to you like, yo, bro, sing.
I'm singing.
What's the note? Right, but also, and the other thing too is what you guys understand about going to an art school is that not everybody thinks like artists. So that person who's coming up to you and saying, oh, you need to sing because if blah, blah, blah came up to you, you would sing for them. They don't get it. They don't think that they're being rude. And they're not trying to be rude. They think that they're encouraging you, when actually sometimes what they might be doing might be making you more nervous and more embarrassed about your choices. So as artists, what you also have to learn to do is to forgive people when they don't understand your art, and forgive them when they don't understand how you go about your art. Lion King, we sing 8 times a week. You think, like, who's a vocalist, just scream like a singer, y'all think is dope? Who's a singer that you think is great? Luciano Pavarotti, when he was alive, all these vocalists, they take care of their instrument. And so it's not always about show and tell. So that's the other thing that you guys will have to remember too, is that your art is to be respected, but because people won't always respect it, you kind of have to program yourself now to just forgive them for not understanding how it is you carry about your music. Last thing, I'll shut up talking. I think it's Miles Davis, who, like, when he would play, he'd be playing like this. Back to the audience the whole time, right?
Yeah.
And people would be mad. They'd be like, yo, bro, we paid you all this money to come see you and your back is to us, and he he's like, you know, first of all, my back is to you so I can, you know, be in harmony with my band who I'm playing with. And two, this is just how I get down. If you don't like it, don't pay for the ticket. So, again, whatever makes you flourish and thrive as an artist may not be what makes the next person thrive as an artist. And so, yeah, just respect your art, know that your art should be respected, but also kind of forgive people in advance if they don't get it, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, go ahead.
Going off of respect and stuff like that, that made me think about a couple of things. Before, you know, you were great. You know, you lived in Chicago, and you know, you had to go through some. You had to go like through people like discouragement.
Sure. Discouragement.
Yeah, discouragement and stuff like that. Like, how did you think about that? You know, before you even went to all of these schools and did everything, like, how did you keep yourself motivated to, you know, keep going?
That's a great question.
Yeah.
For me, what I never really got discouraged because I was so, I knew what I wanted to do. I didn't know I was going to be doing Lion King and Hamilton and a recording artist. I just thought my life was just going to be, I'm going to have hits like Chris Brown, popping on the Grammys, whatever. But I knew inside that that my spirit was called, that I was put here to be an artist. And I think that when you really know that what you're doing is what you're passionate about, all the discouraging comments won't affect you as much. I had a teacher, like when I went to Jones, where you know, Mrs. Kolker was my teacher. I was a really smart kid. I did not get the best grades. One, because I hated it. And I was also distracted by a lot of things. I was on the debate team, I was playing basketball, I had house responsibilities at home with my parents. And so I had to do chemistry like 3 times. I failed chemistry twice. And at Jones, because it's a college prep school, they give you advanced chemistry as a sophomore. First time I got an F, and it's because I really just didn't take time to do the homework. Second time I got an F, I kind of was better, but not really. The third time, and I'm a senior, by the way, taking a chemistry class with a bunch of sophomores. First of all, I wasn't embarrassed about it because, one, I knew I was smart. Two, I was like, this is just a small, this school is such a small part of my life, whatever. But I got a D. At the end of the year, my teacher, my chemistry teacher, who remained nameless, Ms. Recruitus, she called me to the front of the class to get my grade. She says, William, this is what you got. She pointed to a D. She said, this is the grade that you earned. It's a D. This is the grade I want to give you. She pointed to an F. And she says, every morning, not every morning, but like every other week, Mrs. Pope, I could tell you, she would enter me in all these different singing competitions. And so every day people would hear, congratulations to William James for winning first place and blah, 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 blah. This was a constant at my school for 4 years. She says, I don't want you to think that you can sing your way through life. But what you doing? that's literally what she told me. She didn't want to give me a passing grade that I earned in chemistry of all things, because she didn't want me to think that I could just sing my way through life. Needless to say, I was not happy, and I'm gonna tell you what I said. Graduation stage.
What?
With my peers. Yeah, exactly. I was invited to sing at my graduation, but I was not allowed to walk the stage on my own. One of my teachers asked me the same kind of question. He said, Will, like there's so many of your classmates who didn't graduate and they refused to perform. Why would you perform? I said, Mrs. Bennett, like, because I know what my purpose is, I'm not going to get hung up by this one moment. You know what I mean? A lot of people, when they look back on their lives, this would be the highlight of their lives. I said, for me, I know I'm called to do something great. So the point is, when you know that you're connected to what your purpose is, whether it's singing, dancing, acting, or all three, you just stay focused on that. Because over time, like, you know, Indie Aubrey, she wasn't popping as soon as she came out. But, you know, 15, 20 years later, however many years she's been out, she's a millionaire and has a great career. You know what I mean? And she would have got distracted initially because, you know, Adele was more popular than she is, or, you know, Rihanna's records perform better than hers, and she would have stopped because of that. She wouldn't be a millionaire with a great artistic catalog. But because she was so connected to what her purpose was, all the other, you know, distractions and other stuff didn't really get more.
Yeah.
Hi.
What's up?
So when you were like in high school and stuff, you were like still singing and doing stuff. You were doing like gigs and stuff.
You said gigs?
Yeah.
No. But finish your question.
Okay. So like, you know, you'll have like friends or whatever who like ask you to, I'm not going, you know, into the future with like singing theater. But like, you'd have friends who'd ask you to like, hey, could you sing at this? Hey, could you do this? Hey, could you do this? You know, when did you find that it was time to start moving into, you know, professional? Like, you know, you work on your talent, you put a lot into it, you know, you don't want to just keep doing stuff for free, you know what I mean?
Oh, I got you, so.
Like, how did you start from
when? Having a lot of people ask you to do stuff for free.
Yeah.
Like now?
No, I think as an artist, one, you just have to use your own common sense. If somebody's asking you to do a million things that they would ordinarily pay somebody for, but they want you to do it for free, that's probably not something you want to do for free. But the word free as an artist shouldn't be your enemy. As a matter of fact, it's going to be your best friend. Because it's how you make connections, which are incredibly valuable. Most of the people that y'all see on a Broadway stage, even in Hamilton, they're not necessarily there or like, you know, on the Grammys. The people you see on the Grammys ain't necessarily the most talented people. Some of them are just the people who are able to work their connections enough to get into that platform. And a lot of times, doing stuff for free is not only what gets you connections, but it also helps sharpen your art. Because there, you know how many people want to be singers? You know how many people want to be dancers and actors and directors and all that stuff? So many. So if you're always waiting for money to do your art, then you're never going to get better at it. When I left Lion King in Vegas, because I did the Vegas company too, you know, I was going to move to New York. Well, I did move to New York, and I'm auditioning, and I'm telling y'all, I was always in the final callbacks. So all the big shows you connect, it was always down to me and two or three other people for the lead role that I just studied on. And for 3 years in New York, I did not work.
Wow.
Because I was always, auditioning was my full-time job. And I was in New York City, expensive place, and I didn't work. Not because I was turning down free stuff or paid stuff, just because the opportunities weren't there. So I guess I'm saying, sometimes the free stuff is the best thing for you to help you sharpen your craft and to help you stay connected. Because again, if you're always waiting for paid situation, you might be waiting a long time. But again, that doesn't necessarily mean that people should take advantage of your willingness to do free stuff. But you do some free gigs. That's not hurt you. Okay, I guess
this is kind of like off topic. How do you deal with like when you're like on stage? How do you ignore voices in your head?
Yeah.
No, you can't do it. Like, no.
Have you had an experience like that?
I always have.
Yeah. But like in class or like actual performance?
Like, before and after performance, I'm just like, whoa, wait, what am I going to do right now?
Do you practice a lot?
Yeah.
For real?
Yeah.
So do you trust? Do you trust the work that you do when you're practicing?
The thing is, I have a lot of like, whenever it comes to performance, no matter how prepared I am, I guess, for myself, I get too overwhelmed, I guess, and then I just forget everything, and I'm like,
know that that's normal. It's I'm not just saying that to be nice.
Yeah.
That's normal for most artists to be nervous. I had the AC blowing in my face, so my voice is kind of dry. We haven't had the opportunity to do it, is what the brother right here said, which is focusing on the words, focusing on the intention of what you're doing. And also just think about how fun it is. Because if you mess up, so what? What's the worst that can happen if you mess up? I mean, they're professionals who mess up all the time. You know what I mean? Like Usher. I love Usher. Usher is not the best live vocalist. For whatever reason. He's a strong singer. He's not even an auto-tune singer. He's a strong singer. If you look up Usher live, it's not lack of ability. I think he has some nerves or whatever. He's not a strong vocalist, but he still has a great career. He's still enjoying his life. You know, so trust the work that you're doing by yourself, right? But then also just focus on the words, focus on the spirit of what you're doing, and then you'll hopefully that'll help you channel that nervous energy into good nervous energy.
Can you sing us out a little bit?
I'm sorry. I would rather.
Okay, that's fine.
Because I can talk.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
During shows and just like any profession, how do you stay healthy? Because just freshman year has taken a toll on
you. So your question is, how do you take care of yourself? My girlfriend would roll her eyes if she heard me say this right now and call me a hypocrite, but sleep is incredibly important. I don't always get 8 hours of sleep because I have so many things I'm trying to do. I'm trying to record, I have my own blog that I write for, all this other stuff, and I just don't have a lot of time. But singing is one of the best things, resting is one of the best things you can do for your voice and just for your body in general. That's when your body is able to recover. Hydration is key. I don't mean pop, you know what I mean? Mad water. You know what I mean? And don't think that just by drinking a liter of water before you got to sing is going to do it. The hydration process takes 24, 48 hours for your body to really absorb. So just making healthy, responsible choices, eating right, sweating and exercising when you can. You know, it helps your instrument, you know, stay loose and stay ready. So hydration, water, right, all the common sense stuff that Michelle and Mom tell
you.
Why y'all feel
like that? How do you keep your vocal cords in specific
healthy? Well, that comes from good technique. So finding a teacher or teachers who you trust with a great resume. It doesn't mean that they perform on the Grammys or whatever, but like a great artistic resume, a great teaching resume. And because technique will always, I think, save you. There are a lot of people who are singing and they can sing their faces off, like Adele, but she always gets vocal strain because she doesn't necessarily have the best technique to maintain her voice. So the earlier you get technical training as a singer and as a dancer, the healthier your instrument will remain. I think we have one more time for one more question. Yeah.
Real quick, two things. One, you said sleep was very important. Have you ever woke up with a brilliant idea? Is that why you sleep a lot?
You're afraid of losing good ideas? You're afraid of losing good ideas?
No, I said have you ever went to sleep and woke up oh my god, I just came up with the best song ever. Okay. A good dream. Alright, and the second question is, when you're not acting and maybe the season is closed, what do you do for work? On the side?
Looking for more work. When I'm not doing what I'm doing. First of all, during the day when I'm not Lion King, I'm writing my music, preparing for my own albums to be released, and writing for other artists. But when I'm not doing that and there's no show, there's no Lion King, I'm auditioning. Looking for auditions. It's a full-time job to be an artist. Because it's not like being a doctor. You go to school for 8 years, 12 years, blah, blah, blah. You know you've got a pension guaranteed a salary guaranteed for however many years. Being an artist is very different. So every waking moment, even now, should be devoted to, eating and, having fun, but really to perfecting yourself as an artist. Yeah. You can ask me after. All right, thank you guys.